So we're having our second exam on December 12 on Tuesday. It's effectively the last day of class, really. But that means that we don't have to come back in the following week to have our final, since we're doing it this way. So if that will not work out, because we were actually talking about having it this Thursday, if you cannot be here on Tuesday, text me, and I promise we will work it out for you. So just let me know. Do not fret. All right, so we're going to talk about array lists. What is an array list? Well, the problem with arrays is that they are not dynamic data structures. What do I mean by that? Once you fill up an array with data, how are you going to insert a new item into the middle of it? Say you make an array that looks like this. Right? I'm not even typing this into, Java. But suppose you have that, and you want to put a number here. How are you going to do that? The process is really annoying. You create a new array. That's one longer than the old one. Then you copy values from the old one into the new one, inserting your new insertion value into the correct place. So say we wanted to add the number 75 right before the 100. We'd have to allocate a new array. Nums to is equal to new int, but it's going to have to be one more than the other one was, right? Then we can start copying values into it. So nums2 is going to start looking like, when we're done with this, this is not a Java command, right? But we're just going to show what it winds up looking like. It's going to have a 12, a 35. We're just copying item by item, 67. Oh, we have our new item, 75, and then 100. All right, now we want to insert a new value again. You see how many allocations and copying and things like that? That is because arrays are not dynamic. They do not shrink and grow as needed. They're fixed in length, so that's a problem. They are fixed in length. Insertions into them is complex. You can encapsulate it, but it is complex. Deletions from them are complex. Like, what if you wanted to delete that 35? Well, you have to copy the 67 into the 35 spot. You have to copy the 100 into the 67 spot. And you can put a 0 there, or, you could allocate a new array and copy them all in there. Again, insertions and deletions into them are complex. So that's the problem with arrays. The advantage of arrays, they are very fast. They are the fastest data structure because they're just a series of values in memory. So accessing them, you can rip through them as fast as possible, faster than any other form of abstract data type. And I just use the term abstract data type. The array list, which we are going to talk about, is an abstract data type, meaning it is a data type that can use ints, doubles, floats, strings, but it can also use any class that you come up with. Come up with a car class, it can use it. Come up with a shape class, it can use it. A circle class, a printer class, a name class, an employee. So an array list can hold any of that kind of data. Well, an array can too. And then it gives you additional capabilities that an array does not support. There are other kinds of abstract data types. There's one known as a stack, and there's one known as a queue. I'm not going to talk about a stack right now, but a queue is like a printer queue. You insert items onto one of them, one side, and you take items off from the other. Yeah, you could write an array that did that, but again, you have the problem that's fixed in length, that if your queue grows too long, you have to allocate a new array, copy stuff into it. So, array lists. Advantage? Okay, yeah, so let's say. The problem with arrays is that the advantage is access is very quick. and very similar for any language you will use. You guys who've taken Python or are taking C++ can attest that the array code and the list code in Python and what we're doing in here are all very similar, right? Especially for you poor folks who've been sitting through the same lectures in C++. I won't say poor folk. For those of you who are getting the advantage of the double lectures on arrays. So array lists, their advantage is that they are dynamic. Insertions, deletions work like magic. Really cool. Work with single method calls that you don't have to write. So let's go make an array list. How many of y'all are going to take Java 2 next semester? Excellent, excellent. You'll like it. You'll like it a lot. If you've taken both intro to programming and then you took scripting, there was a lot of overlap, right? When we go into Java 2, there's not going to be nearly as much overlap with Java as there was in that class. You know, uncharted territory. Yeah, there's got to be some overlap, but it's going to be good stuff. It's my favorite class to teach. Oh, I can't say that. I like lots of classes. Alrighty. So I'm going to make a new project. Java next. Java application, whatever. Now, the array list is not a primitive data type like an int or a float. It is its own class. So we're going to have to add an import for it. But I'm going to be totally lazy and let NetBeans do the import for me. So I'm just going to declare an array list. The syntax for declaring an array list looks a little bit odd. Here's how we declared an array, right? Int IA is equal to new int, right? Like that. I don't care if you type that or not, but here is what an array list looks like. Array list, angle brace, data type, IList is equal to new array list, capital L, capital A, angle braces, parentheses, in parentheses. And you go, what the? I don't know what that means. That's okay. It's one of those things that, you know, the syntax for arrays didn't look right the very first time you saw it. The syntax for this doesn't look right the first time you see it. But it starts to make sense. Remember when I said that this is an abstract data type that can accept any kind of class? We're saying I want an array list, and I want it to support integers. This has to be a class, though. It can't be a primitive data type. You can't do an array list of int. If this starts with a lowercase letter, it's not going to work with an array list. Fortunately, the wrapper classes, capital I, integer, capital D, double, work just like ints and, you know, and floats and doubles and stuff like that, so you can use them seamlessly. They were designed to be, you know, to carry integers around when you needed class references or object references rather than primitives. Okay, it's complaining it doesn't know what an array list is. All we have to do is add java.util.arraylist up to the top. I'm going to let NetBeans do that for me. Thank you very much. Add import java.util.arraylist. I'm getting some kind of goofball error here. Oh, because I deleted the package statement. Move class to correct folder. Alrighty, let's add some data to our iList. iList.add. Let's add 100 to it. iList.add 200. iList.add 300. They're accessed very similarly, but they are very different beasts under the seams. An array list is built using something called a linked list, which I'll get up on the board and I'll draw in a minute, and that'll be the last thing we do before the review. Okay, so we've added three items to it. iList dot add. Add a 400, but we want it to be the first element in the list, so now we're doing an insert. It was that easy. We didn't have to write any complex code, you know, that would copy arrays or anything like that. Well, let's print it out. Let's just use a for each loop because it's so easy. For int I colon in the I list system dot out dot print line I. That syntax looks exactly the same, right? If that was an array or this is an array list, looks exactly the same. That's kind of nice. Let's run it and see if it works. Where's my output? Ew, and it blew up. What did I do wrong? Oh. Well, that's annoying. Switch gears. Make this an array of strings, or an array list of strings. Array list, angle brace, string, angle brace. Let's call it S list, is equal to new array list. We don't have to specify the data type again. This call figures out that it's an array list of strings based on how it's defined.
If you switch Oh,
is that the line that's the problem? Okay, undo. Sorry about that, guys. Undo all those changes and just make it look like this. 0, 400. Thank you. If you have two values, the first number is the index and the second number is the value you are inserting. I forgot my semicolon. Undid too many things. And there we go, 400, 100, 200, 300.
So push it, so now it has four values instead of three. So it's not replacing the one.
It did not replace it. You're exactly correct. You're right. So let's talk about how to get values out of it. If I want the first value, it looks like this. Int x is equal to iList.get. That is opposed to doing x is equal to ia.0. Slightly different syntax, but that's because this is a class, and so we have methods that act upon that class. What if we want to change that value? iList.set element 0 to a new value, to 500. And let's print them out again. I'm going to be totally lazy and just copy that. Alrighty, so it changed the first value from 400 to a 500. This is how you pull items out with dot get. Let's add on to our little notes. Declare an array list. Import java.util.arrayList. java.util.star would be good enough. Then declare one. What was the syntax? Array list. And then what was our special syntax different from arrays? Just scroll up in your code and you can tell me. Angle brace. And then we have the data type. And the true or false, the data type has to be a class, not a primitive. True. You can use wrapper classes. Then you give it a list name. And then you invoke the ArrayList ArrayList constructor with a pair of parentheses. All right. Then you call dot add. To add x, to append x to the end of the list. Call ilist.add 0, x to insert x into the beginning of the list. Whatever this index number is, it just inserts it at that point, right? So this value of x becomes the new beginning of the list. But if you did add 1, x, then it would make it so that this value was the first element, the second element of the list, not the beginning of the list. Does that make sense? It'd push everything down but leave the first element alone. V is equal to ilist.get. It's kind of the same as IA subscript 3, right? Get a value from the list. You understand what I mean by that, right? We've done arrays for a month. We know what that looks like. And then you want to change it. ilist.set 3, and then the value that we're trying to set it to. It's kind of like saying IA subscript 3 is equal to X. All right, array lists are cool because they're dynamic. The way they work behind the scenes, and I'm going to use the term linked list. They actually use a somewhat more sophisticated structure than a linked list. But the idea of a linked list is a good start at talking about what they are. Okay, so what is a linked list? Imagine an array that had two pieces, two columns, rather than just one. It had a value, and it had a next. And so you wrote a value out. You wrote the name, the color blue. Somewhere you have a pointer, a reference saying that the beginning of the linked list, the start of the linked list, is element 0. And we're going to say that the end of the linked list is negative 1. That's how we know that there's no other items in it, right? So now we go and we add another one. We append another one. So we append another color to it. That's at element 1, so we have to update our next counter. The next one is a 1, and then that's the end of the list. Then we come along, and we want to append another one. So, green. That becomes a negative 1, and what does this become? It's pointing to the next number. Yeah, it becomes a 2. Okay. I'm going to fill in a couple more. Black, white. Alrighty, now we're going to delete an element from our list. We want to delete green from our list. So we search the list for that value. Is that green? Nope. Okay, skip to the next one. Is that green? Nope, skip to that one. Is that green? It sure is. So what we do is we update this counter to skip that one, right? Now nothing is using this one. Maybe we have another list pointing out, you know, free elements so that we could then come back and use that one. Then we decide we're going to delete blue. We don't want blue in here anymore. So we search at the beginning. Go here. Ah, we found it right away. We change our beginning of our list to 1. So that the next time we start iterating through the list, we start here rather than there. And like I said, maybe we have some special way of going through it and finding which one is next. What you really do is instead of constructing this as an array, you construct it as a linked list of references. But I'm doing it as an array just because the numbers make sense. Hope that makes sense. So if you were going to insert a new value, we want to insert something between black and white that says orange. Here's what you do. You find a blank spot in it. I'm just going to go to the bottom. You write it there. And it's supposed to be after black. So put a 5 there. There was a 4 there, so we put a 4 there. Right? So now if we're going to follow them, where's our beginning? So we would print out red. We would jump to the 3rd one. We'd print out black. We'd jump to the 5th one. We'd print out orange. We'd jump to the 4th one. We'd print out white. Now we're done because we don't have any more items. Hope that makes sense. That's a linked list. You can make a doubly linked list where you have a next and a previous counter, right? Because it'd be impossible to work your way back, you know, given any specific element. And you can write much faster algorithms if you have a doubly linked list. Then there are other structures called trees. The advantage of a tree over a list is that they remain sorted. This array list that we're creating is not sorted, right? We added numbers to it, and we kind of added them sequentially, but then we started inserting things in the beginning, run their order. So array lists are implemented behind the scenes as a linked list. And if you took programming courses back in the 80s, 90s, you wrote a whole bunch of linked list code. Nowadays, you use these standardized libraries that come with these things. But if you go onto a 4-year college and take a data structures class, you'll probably get to write your own lists anyways.
All right, let's go to review.
All righty. So the best review is to look at the quizzes. The questions on the exam are going to look a lot like the question on the quizzes. There'll be a few, you know, freehand writing of code. There'll be things like declare an array of ints. name the array, values, make the array 5 elements long, assign the first value of the array equal to 10, like that. So I should say declare and allocate an array of ints. It is a good idea to type this stuff, but it's also going to be in the video, you know, so. But I'm not going to save this document. Okay, so. Like the exams, like the quizzes, know the difference between and or, you know. That one's that, that one's that. Know the truth table for each. That's real simple and old school, you know, for us now. Be able to write a switch statement. We've done switches, pretty sure. You know, with several cases. I'll tell you what the numbers are, you know. May just be as easy as, you know, 90A, you know, or something like that. I'll give you the values and what I wanted to print. I'm pretty sure we discussed short-circuiting, but I'm going to mention again. Short-circuiting means skipping part of an evaluation that uses AND or. If you have this, if A and B, except you'd really use those symbols. If A is false, do you even need to know what B is? No, because you already know the whole expression is false, so you can skip it. That's called short-circuiting. And you can use that when you're trying to optimize your loops or whatever to make sure that, you know, the easier one to evaluate or the one that's going to turn false more often is the first one, because that'll be the fastest way to eliminate the whole thing. You won't have to do the more complex evaluation there. So if the first one is false, skip evaluating the second half. For or, it's the other way around. If A or B. If A is false, you do have to evaluate B. But if A is true, you already know the end result, right? You don't have to check B if A is true, because or requires only one of them to be true. If the first one is true, skip evaluating the second half. So that's short-circuiting. Loops. Just like our quizzes, write a loop that will count from 10 to 20, you know, that kind of thing, inclusive. Write a loop that will count from 100 to 200 by tens. I'm not going to ask any questions about what's the third kind of loop, do while loops. So I'm going to ask about while and for. Just know the syntax for each. I know y'all already know it. You don't go and re-familiarize yourself, but you know, y'all got great scores on the quizzes, so I know. So index of searches a string, right? So if you do string is equal to rows, and then you do x is equal to s dot index of r, that's equal to zero because r is the first letter. If you do x is equal to s dot index of e, what's the value going to be? Well, that's zero. So the index of the e is what? Three. Yeah, because that's zero, one, two, and three. What if we look for a letter that's not in it? It's going to return negative one. If the character is not in the string, it returns negative one, meaning not found. Remember what math.floor and math.seal do. Math.floor rounds a fraction down. 2.5, you know, would become a 2. Math.seal rounds up. Round is the wrong term, really, because even 2.1 would become 3, right? Whereas even 2.99 would become 2. Floor just means chop off the decimal, you know, go down to 2. Ceiling means go to the next highest whole number. So it becomes 3. I know y'all already know POW and ABS. POW, X to the Y, you know what that means. And the absolute value of negative 3 is what? It's equal to 3. Absolute value of positive 3 is equal to 3. Substring. So if you have this string, S is equal to, Tony Stark, like that. And then you say print line S dot substring 2, 5. What is that going to print? This means starting at index 2 and going up to but not including index 5. So which letter is index 2? Well, that's 0. That's 1. That's 2. Now we need to go up to but not including 5. So if that's 2, that's 3, that's 4, and that's 5. So starting at 2, going not up to 5, that's NYS. That would print out NYS. My quick way of remembering it, so I don't have to count out as much, is just to go, okay, 5 minus 2 is 3. So I'm going to start at 2 and get 3 characters. 0, 1, 2, get those 3. Writing methods. Do I even have to list problems? Write a method called times 3. That returns double the value passed in. That kind of thing. Know what void means. Just means that it doesn't have a return value, right? That printf stuff that we haven't used much. Just make a little note to yourself. You want to print a decimal, a floating point, you use point F, and this number specifies a number of decimal places. That will print X to 4 decimal places. If X is a integer, you better not use percent F. Print F percent 4D, and you need to pass in an integer. We'll print I to fill 4 spaces. If we put a number before this dot, it would fill it out to that many spaces. Let's do that. So percent 9.4F. We'll print X to 4 decimal places, filling 9 spots, 9 spaces. And it'll pad it out. If you want to change the padding, you put a minus sign and it'll be left justified rather than right. Padding with left spaces. Same's true for this one. Okay, now, lots of people didn't quite get what I wanted to say here, but I don't think I reiterated often enough. Professor Thompson's guidelines for creating classes. Y'all opened a book and you got some good answers, you know, for writing classes. But, you know, I'm terribly vain. I want you to remember my own. So, data, private, methods, public, getters, and setters. Add custom constructors if they make it easier to use. Add toString to make it easy to print the object. And I may have thrown in more or less, but that's quite enough, you know. And if you get four of those, that's great. And if you throw in some other stuff, that's also cool. Write clear code, very important. If you have a return statement, put it at the beginning or the end. On one of your quizzes, you had return at the beginning, and then I put, I don't understand what you mean. Then I figured it out. I didn't go back and revise your comment. Yes, I know what you mean by put the return at the beginning. But you put it either at the beginning or the end. And what does that mean? And I'm not going to list it as one of my things. But if you write a function like this, int foo, you know, and it does something, it opens a file. But if it can't open the file, just return right away at the very beginning. Don't return from inside a great big block of code. And then you do all your stuff, and you could put a return zero, you know, or whatever you were supposed to return, you know, return to total. That's just an example. But to make it easy to read your code, your return statements should be at the bottom. If you have to return at early, then you can return early in it to function. And the reason you do that is to weed out error conditions. I can't open that file. No, I can't divide by zero. No, you didn't give me a valid name. That kind of stuff. You can return early out of that. You validate that you have good data. And then you have all your loops and stuff that does good stuff. So the book has excellent points to make. And those of y'all who quoted it, that's good. I don't think I deducted much, if anything. But I'd really like for y'all to say something like that when I ask, what are the guidelines, Jeff's guidelines for making good classes. There was another question like that, and now I'm not remembering them. You know how to write getters and setters already, right? Int x, int get x, returns this dot x. I'm going to have y'all tell me what the next one should be. I'm going to make a set x. What should it look like? What should I make its return type? Void. And I know we let NetBeans do that too often, probably, if we took advantage of its encapsulate feature. And what should I put in here? I want to set it to something. So set it to int x. And inside of the braces, how do I set the value of this object's x value? This dot x is equal to the x parameter passed in. Make sense? Good there? If we're not, wave your hand. I mean, totally, this is review, but review is a good time for asking questions. Oh yeah, the other one, but I think everybody got this. A class, in my definition, is a collection of data and the methods that act upon it. Can you have a class with no data? Sure. Can you have a class with no methods? Yeah. But in general, it's a collection of data and the methods that act upon it. Now we're getting into the weird stuff. It's not that weird, but the static keyword. Use static to declare class members. Non-static, which is not a keyword, you just leave out the static keyword, makes instance members. What's the difference? To access a class member, you use a class name in front of the dot. Like this, math.pow. Right? We know that's a class because it begins with an uppercase M, so this is a class method. We did not have to declare a math object. So that means that since this is a class method, how do you declare class with this static keyword? But scanners, nextInt, sc.nextInt, the thing in front of the period is lowercase. So is that a class or is that an object, an instance? Uppercase means class, lowercase means instances or variables. So this is an instance method, meaning that it was not declared static. And if you get those mixed up, you know, it's only going to be a couple of points, but it sure would be nice if you got it right. And I think most people got it right. Which is a better statement? An object is an instance of a class, or a class is an instance of an object? The class is the blueprint, the house is the object, so the object is the instance of the class. That's why we use the term instantiate. Each time you make a new member of it, you're making something from that class. What are getters and setters more officially known as? One of them is known as an accessor, and one of them is known as a mutator. Which is which? Which one's the mutator? Setter. Yeah, the setter, because it changes the data. It mutates it. So the getter is the accessor. All right. I'm not going to give you every single question on it, of course. I'll just give you the easy ones. I'm going to keep secret the hard ones, and I'm kidding about that. My voice is holding out better than I thought it would. All righty. If I asked you what is a constructor and I told you not to look it up in the book and give me a book definition, what is a constructor? It's got several aspects. In that quiz, I listed like 8 or 9 things and then I said they're all true. So a constructor is a method that has the same name as the class, has no return type, is called by the new keyword, and can be used to assign values to the instance variables. Of the class. So if we have a class called Pooh Bear, and we wanted to write a customized constructor, a parameterized constructor, that took a string called name as its parameter. That's enough. It doesn't even have to do anything with it. Let's just write the constructor method header. So you'd want to make it public, because if it's private, then it couldn't be invoked. Then what should its name be? What should the name of the constructor be? According to my first law of, it should be called Pooh Bear. Should I make a public void Pooh Bear, or is public Pooh Bear enough? It has no, okay, yeah, I see why you said that. Not even void. It just has no return type defined whatsoever. Sorry, guys. And then, since this is a parameterized constructor, we need something between the parentheses. So it's a string called name. right? That's enough. All righty. How about a default constructor? That accepts no parameters. Real easy. It's the same thing, but you don't put anything between the parentheses, right? Public Pooh Bear, like that. Then you put, you know, in parentheses and anything, or, you know, curly braces and whatever it was supposed to do. You know, this dot name is equal to name. Let's go ahead and put that. So in the parameterized constructor, this dot name equals name, just like a setter. But public Pooh Bear doesn't have to do anything. It's not accepting any parameters, so why make it do anything? True, false. You usually make constructors public. Yeah, true. You remember that stuff in the quiz about if you have a circle and you want to make a new circle, you do, you know, circle C1 is equal to new circle. Just know how to do that. And circle C2 is equal to new circle, but you pass in a radius like that. This one would have to have a default constructor, but the default constructor is given to you automatically by the compiler unless you add a custom constructor, a parameterized constructor. Once you tack this on, the compiler stops giving you this. But anyways, so if you were going to call the default constructor, you do it with nothing between the parentheses. If you're going to call the parameterized constructor, you put something between the parentheses. Just go back to the quiz and you'll see what the questions look like for that. All right, arrays. We talked about arrays for a month. They should be fresh in our brain. By the way, the quizzes are all open again, so you can retake them. Get your extra points. Till like Tuesday of next week, or Sunday, the week after finals. Well, that's kind of like a drop-dead day for all the assignments and stuff. Alrighty, you know how to declare an array. Know how to reference the elements of the array. If an array is 20 elements long, the first index is what? Well, it doesn't matter the length of the array. What is the first index of any array?
Zero.
And then what is the last index? It'll be 20 minus 1. Write loops that will print an array. Write loops that will add all the values in an array. Know what a parallel array is. What is a parallel array? I've given the definition a couple of times. Just save yourself some time so you don't have to Google it. What is one? Or actually, it's plural. Sorry, but yeah. Yeah, keep going. Sorry, I interrupted you.
Oh, just they contain common data or common data field.
Right, two arrays of the same length. Linked by their index value. What is the concern about partially filled arrays? Why did we go so long about talking about partially filled arrays? What's the problem with them? You declare an array of 100 elements, but you've only filled the first 10. Is that a problem, like if you're going to print them out, or if you're going to calculate an average? Yeah, it's a problem. What is the problem? Yeah, the average is very much a problem because you have to know how many elements are valid. So that's the trick. When you're working with a partially filled array, you have to keep track of how many elements are valid so that you don't print out the invalid ones and so you don't use them to calculate averages or other things like that. I'll let you figure out how to word what I just said. You have to keep track of how many elements are filled. You can't just go from beginning to end. Just review the arrays quiz. Take it a second time. Don't look at your past answers, you know. Just take it a second time. I'll make it so that you can take it three times so that, you know, the third time you can just wrap it up and, you know, get a perfect score on it. I could do that for all the quizzes, actually. I'll do that. I'll change them so that you have three attempts on them rather than two if you want to go and scoop up a couple extra points here and there.
And that'd be a perfect
way of studying for the test. Yep, exactly. Just retaking the quizzes would burn this stuff into the exam so that you'd rip through it in record time. All right. Why don't we call ourselves done? Are there any questions? Exam's on Thursday, is it? Yes. Thursday, yeah. Validate that. Tuesday, December 19th.
Oh.
But we changed it. This is a Java class, so it's going to be Tuesday of next week, right? Yeah, sorry. For a second, I thought I was in C++. And I'm not even on cough syrup yet. Okay, so I'll see y'all Thursday. We're going to talk more about abstract data types, like queues and array lists, but those are not going to be on the exam. So you're safe in studying what we've already talked about and running through the quizzes again. Any questions? Oh, and please come ahead and show up so that we can do these instructor evaluations on Thursday. So y'all can get me a raise or, you know, get me demoted, whatever you want. Okay, gang. Did you send me a text about taking the exam? All right. Let's not. We'll recover the array list stuff on Thursday and we'll upload it then. Alrighty. So, you C++ guys, I'll see you in a few minutes. Okay.